All right, last time we were looking at body plan, and this table summarizes the body plans phylum by phylum and compares them phylum by phylum. And then we're going to go on and take a look at evolutionary trends, and we'll be looking at evolutionary trends system by system. But this table also shows that there are evolutionary trends in terms of these different characteristics of body plan. So the first thing you want to note here is what are we talking about when we're talking about body plan? It's these components together that describe the body plan of an animal. So the number of germ layers they have. And if you'll recall, there can be either two or three. Body symmetry. So are they asymmetrical, radially symmetrical, pentaradially symmetrical, bilaterally symmetrical? That's what we're talking about there. Cephalization. In other words, do they have a head? Because some animals don't have a head. So cephalization simply refers to having a head. If an animal has a head, then it's referred to as being cephalized. And then there's the coelom, which is that second body cavity other than the digestive cavity. So there's another cavity in the animal. If they have a coelom, there's another cavity in the animal other than the digestive cavity. And that cavity is either is between tissues. It's a cavity either between or within tissues. And then the early development is referring to embryonic development. And more specifically, do they show protostome development or deuterostome development? So those are the things that we're talking about when we're talking about body plan. And of course, I've made a lot of modifications here to try to make things a little bit more clear and also make sure that the phylum names are used here. And one of the things that you'll want to keep track of for each of these characteristics of body plan is which animals were the first to have each one. So, for example, germ layers, porifera have no true tissues. So they really don't have tissue layers. Remember, germ layers can also be referred to as tissue layers. Well, if you have no true tissues, like porifera don't, then they're not going to have either two germ layers or three germ layers. They can't have germ layers. They can't have tissue layers because they don't have tissues. So cnidarians were the first to have true tissues. So that's something to note about cnidarians. And when I say note about cnidarians, what I would recommend is that you go back to the phylogenetic tree project and add this information to the project. In other words, make sure that you have, and you should already have it labeled for porifera, that they don't have true tissues. And then cnidarians have two tissue layers or germ layers. And then flatworms, Phylum Platyhelminthes, is the first to have three. And that's a unique characteristic that appears in Platyhelminthes. And notice that I made that underline an arrow because that's a characteristic that carries on through the rest of the animal kingdom. In other words, Phylum Platyhelminthes were the first, or was the first, to have three germ layers. And all animals that have evolved since have three germ layers. So there's an evolutionary trend here from no germ layers to two germ layers to three germ layers, and then that carries on throughout evolution. If we look at body symmetry, remember porifera have indeterminate growth, which means that they have no symmetry at all. They have no particular way of growing, therefore there's no pattern to them, therefore there's no symmetry. So they're asymmetrical. It says here absent, but asymmetrical it would be a better term to associate with that. And then cnidarians, and remember, Ctenophorans are along with cnidarians here. So phylum Cnidaria, phylum Ctenophora have radial symmetry. That's circular symmetry, right? And then flatworms, Platyhelminthes, again, were the first to be bilaterally symmetrical, and I made that underline an arrow because that carries on throughout animal evolution. Everything that comes after phylum Platyhelminthes shows bilateral symmetry. And it gets a little weird though. The only caveat to that, the only exception to that, is that when we get to echinoderms, adult echinoderms don't show bilateral symmetry. They show pentaradial symmetry. But that's only as adults. Notice the asterisks here and the footnote that I put down here. Echinoderm larvae, their larvae are both bilaterally symmetrical and cephalized, whereas the adults are pentaradially symmetrical. But their larvae being bilaterally symmetrical shows the evolutionary link that starts here with phylum Platyhelminthes and the evolution of bilateral symmetry. All right. So I just mentioned cephalization down here too for echinoderms, and that's the next characteristic. So cephalization of them being having a head, and sponges, you know, very simple, barely more than a colony. They don't have, you know, indeterminate growth, no set pattern to their bodies, which means that they're not going to have a head. So acephalized would be a better way of referring to that, or a better term. A, you know, you put an A in front of anything in biology, and it means without or not, or the opposite of, and in this case, without a head. Acephalized, or acephalic. Same with cnidarians. They're acephalic. Again, Platyhelminthes is the first to have a head. And so I made that arrow, I made that underline an arrow because, that is an evolutionary advancement that carries on throughout the rest of the animal kingdom, starting with phylum Platyhelminthes. So hopefully you're getting the idea that phylum Platyhelminthes is a really important phylum in terms of evolution, the evolution of these characteristics that all, that most animals, I should say, that most animals share. And again, cephalization is that other characteristic that's kind of weird when we get to the phylum Echinodermata, because adult echinoderms are not considered to have a head. They're acephalized, but their larvae show cephalization. Their larvae show, have a structural arrangement that represents a head. Or I should say that presents a head. Next is the coelom. That second cavity other than the digestive cavity. And again, sponges being so simple, phylum Porifera, it's absent. So they are acoelomates. Again, put an A in front of it, it means without, right? Acoelomates. Cnidarians also acoelomates. We get the Platyhelminthes. This time, we don't see this evolutionary advancement in Platyhelminthes. So again, acoelomate. Then we get to nematodes, phylum Nematoda, the roundworms, and they are the first to have some kind of second body cavity other than the digestive cavity. But it's in between the endoderm and the mesoderm. It's a cavity that's in between the mesoderm and the endoderm, which means it's not completely within mesoderm. The definition of a true coelom is that it's completely lined by mesoderm. It's completely within mesoderm, as we say. And when it comes to nematodes and other related phyla, they have what we refer to as a pseudocoelom, a false coelom, because it's not completely within mesoderm. We don't see a true coelom, what we refer to as a eucoelom. Remember, eu means true. So we want to refer to these as eucoelomates. And the arrow here is suggesting that we need to switch Mollusca and Annelida in terms of the order of evolution. I think it's because of segmentation, we want to consider Mollusca to have evolved before annelids, because segmentation is a further evolutionary advancement. And so mollusks not being segmented should come before annelids, which are segmented. And mollusks are the ones that we want to consider to be the first eucoelomates. They're the first to have a true coelom. And that carries on through annelids and arthropods and echinoderms and chordates. And that brings up another point here. The phylum Chordata, the very last phylum on the phylogenetic tree, of the animal kingdom, is not included on this table. And that's because we share all these characteristics with larval echinoderms. So echinoderms and chordates share the same characteristics, but you need to remember that we're talking about larval echinoderms, not the adult echinoderms, because the adult echinoderms are weird. Let's just put it that way. They're weird. because they undergo this metamorphosis into an adult that is acephalized and shows radial pentaradial symmetry. And that's just weird. A lot of other weird things about them too, and you'll learn that when we get to studying that phylum specifically. So that brings us to embryonic development, and you'll notice that they just have lines here for Porifera cnidaria, and that's because we don't really talk about protostome versus deuterostome development until we get to an animal that has three tissue layers. So because Platyhelminthes was the first to have three tissue layers, that means Platyhelminthes is the first to show protostome development. And remember, that's development where the mouth forms first. Proto means first and stome means mouth, so first mouth. And that appears in Platyhelminthes and carries on through phylum Nematoda and phylum Mollusca and phylum Annelida. And that, again, I'm listing these in evolutionary order because we're switching mollusks and annelids. And Arthropoda. But when we get to Echinodermata and Chordata, it switches to deuterostome development. So deuterostome development evolves in echinoderms first and carries on to phylum Chordata. And that's why that underline is an arrow. And remember that deuterostome means second mouth, mouth second. In embryonic development. So the first opening in the embryo is the anus, and that's how we develop, because we're in the phylum Chordata. I added two other characteristics here to the table because, in my opinion, they do have to do with body plan. And so the first one is, three other things. And the first one is multicellularity. And remember, that's the synapomorphy, basically, that makes an animal an animal, being multicellular. So Porifera were the first to be multicellular, and notice that that's an arrow, so that carries on through the entire animal kingdom. Because all animals, there's no such thing as a unicellular animal. They're all multicellular. We're all multicellular, I should say. So that's the only place it is on the table, is for phylum Porifera. And then what I added was the digestive system. And really, Poriferans don't have a digestive system, so to speak, because they are digesting their food intracellularly, like protists do, like protozoans do. They take in food particles into the cells and digest the food inside cells. Cnidarians have evolved some extracellular digestion along with a two-way digestive system. Two-way meaning that there's only one opening. They only have a mouth, and you really should refer to that as a mouth slash anus, because it functions as both the mouth and the anus. What the food that comes in the mouth, once what can't be digested, the non-digestible waste goes back out the mouth. So it's a two-way digestive system, meaning that the food comes in one way and the non-digestible waste goes out the opposite direction. So it's two-way, like a two-way street. Same with phylum Platyhelminthes. They only have one opening. They don't have an anus. And I know this thing looks more like a normal animal that has a head. And usually the mouth is at the head, but in these guys, the mouth isn't even at the head. It's in the middle of their belly, basically. And that's the only opening. So the food goes in, what can't be digested comes back out the mouth. So it's a two-way digestive system, just like in cnidarians. Then we have the first, and this is where you'll want to note, is the first alimentary canal, the first one-way digestive tract, as we call it, evolves in the roundworms, phylum Nematoda, and that's an arrow because it carries on through the rest of animal evolution. So that's something to note about the digestive tract. The other thing that I added here has to do with segmentation, because that is an evolutionary advancement, and it does have to do with the body plan. So again, mollusks, all the way up through mollusks, are not segmented, but then the annelids, phylum Annelida, are the first to be segmented, and that's actually what the phylum name refers to. Annel means ring. And if you've ever looked along an earthworm, you'll notice that their body is made up of rings. All along their body is made up of rings, and those rings are segments. So segmentation evolves in Annelida, and it carries on. That's an arrow, so it carries on through Arthropoda, any kind of Dermata and Chordata, and there's a phylum that's missing here that's on the phylogenetic tree, and that would be Tardigrada. So those are evolutionary trends that we see in the body plan. And we're going to go on, like I said, to look at the evolutionary trends in different systems. But this is make sure that you transfer this information to your phylogenetic tree helper sheet. Oh, and I just realized that I missed that I added exoskeleton here too. And likewise, you could put endoskeleton here. Actually, I'm going to do that. So I just added endoskeleton, and notice it's underlined with an arrow because it evolves first in echinoderms and it carries on through the phylum Chordata, including us.